All right. Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming out tonight to Cosmic Conversations. My name is Mike McConville. I'm the coordinator of the planetarium, and I'm really honored to be able to be your host for tonight's festivities. And so before we begin and get into the really, really great stuff tonight, there are just a few housekeeping things we want to take care of. The first, of course, is to thank our sponsors for tonight. And so in this event and all of the events of Space Week 2018, our main corporate sponsor has been the CFE Federal Credit Union. And so they've been able to invest in our vision for what science should be here in Central Florida and to serve as a gateway to our community to bring science to people who may not necessarily have access to it. And that's a really important thing as we move forward. And of course, with some of the things we're gonna talk about tonight. Our other major sponsor tonight is the Central Florida Astronomical Society. They were gracious enough to be able to sponsor our refreshments tonight, a little meet and greet with Nicole before the event. And I hope everybody from CFIS who came out had a really great time kind of picking her brain over the last few minutes. But of course, for those of you here, we are going to bring our audience participation right at the very beginning. This is a sit down. And that means that we want your questions 10, 15 minutes into all of this. So if you've got some questions for Nicole, please be ready to share those with us. And for those of you who are joining us online, thank you. And if you want to participate, you can send questions our way, primarily through Twitter. You want to use the hashtag Cosmic Conversations, or you can tweet directly at the planetarium. That's at Seminole Planet, and we'll be able to incorporate those into the interview as well. But what's important tonight is our esteemed guest. She has spent over 100 days in space. She has been a member of the Space Shuttle missions and ISS. She is an astronaut, an aquanaut, and an artist. And she has one of the most eclectic resumes of any astronaut you're ever going to meet. And we are incredibly happy to have her with us tonight. So ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm Seminole State welcome to the incredible Nicole Stott. Thank you, Nicole. All right, and then we'll just make sure we are ready to go. All right. And so Nicole, of course, thank you for joining us tonight. First question, most important question of all, would you rather be in orbit right now? Being able to get everybody out there in space. Oh, so as we're kind of moving things around, so we'll, there we go. So,
that's not me now.
Is that me or? It's the cable. Fun. So you guys get to see all the behind the scenes stuff. All right, so now, her cable? Oh. Sounds lit. So you can see what gets to happen in, here in the background. Let's make sure that we're.
Oh, maybe. There you go.
How about that?
Green light. How about now? Can you hear me now?
Okay, perfect.
All right.
So we'll get this right eventually. But Nicole, we wanted to start off tonight with probably the simplest of all questions. A little bit about your background. And of course, don't want to give too much away, but a graduate of both Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in Daytona and the University of Central Florida here in Orlando. So we get to claim her as a local girl, which is really, really nice. But Nicole, if you would, a little bit about yourself and what brought you to the point of becoming an astronaut.
Well, I think if I look back on it, I think the most important thing was growing up with people who enjoyed sharing what they loved with me. And, you know, I mean, I can use my parents as the best example, I guess. You know, my mom, I think about it now. I mean, she made almost all of my clothes growing up, mine and my sister's. And, I mean, it's difficult for me to even figure out how to have the time to go to Target to get my son's, you know, a new pair of shorts or something, let alone even imagining making, you know, his clothes. And she was creative in a number of other ways as well. And so she shared all that with me as I was growing up, just because she loved it. And, you know, whether or not I would latch on to that later, she didn't know, but she knew. She enjoyed it. My dad was the same way. He loved to fly. He built and flew small airplanes. And so either in our garage at home or out at the local Clearwater Air Park, which is where I spent most of my childhood growing up, was hanging out with my family at that airport. And eventually that just became, for me, I developed this love of flying and wanting to know how things fly. And we were talking out in the other space out there about, if you want to know how things fly, why would you not want to know how rocket ships fly? And, there's this beautiful Kennedy Space Center, right down the road from here. It was across the state for me as I grew up. And it just seemed to be this, kind of, why would you not want to work at the Kennedy Space Center where, where there's space shuttles launching and things? And I did have, I have memory of watching the first moon landing too with my family, grilled cheese sandwich in front of the TV and then going out and looking at the moon later and stuff. But it was from that point and for a really long time, while I really thought that was cool, wow, people are doing this, it was other people. To me, it seemed like that's something other people do. It's not something I would do. And it wasn't until probably 9 years into the 10 and a half years that I worked at KSC that I started thinking about astronaut as a possibility. And what I'm really thankful for, and this is, for some of the stuff, we were talking about here in the front, is no one ever told me I couldn't do something, unless it was, I was going to hurt myself, maybe, which makes me wonder why my mom never stopped me from loading onto a rocket ship. But they did. I was always had people supporting me, and I'm very thankful for that. It makes me very sad when I see someone being told or discouraged about something. And I think one of the best things we can do, maybe two of the best things we can do for folks, are share what we love with them and not discourage them in the things they discover that they love.
Now, you, of course, mentioned your time at working for NASA, and you worked in the processing facility mm-hmm. for the shuttles. Tell us a little bit about what it was like to be working on the shuttle program, really in the heyday of it, in the 90s and the early 2000s.
This word will be used a lot out of my mouth. It was awesome. It really was. And I think we have some people here that, that work at KSC, worked there. The people that work at KSC and that did during the shuttle timeframe, absolutely passionately believed that their job was the care and feeding of those vehicles. And really and truly, and believed that, they loved coming to work. This was, working there is more than a job. It is a passion thing. And to be in that kind of place, essentially right out of college in the orbiter processing facility, which is, really just a big hangar for the orbiters. And, like any job, there's gonna be the bad, the bad days or the frustrating days. But when you can walk down stairs and then go and stand underneath, a space shuttle and look at it, touch it, talk to the people that are working on it, to me, there was nothing better than that. And I think that mentality of the kind of people that want to work in the space business, it's still the same. As we're moving towards new vehicles, or as we're developing new technology, or even as we're launching on Soyuz spacecraft with our Russian partners, there is very much a passion, care, and feeding thing that goes along with it. And there's no better place to work than someplace like that.
Of course. Now, given your educational background, Embry-Riddle, and then of course later UCF, for those in our audience who may themselves want to be rocket scientists someday, or strap themselves into a rocket and blast off into space, what did you study in school, and how did you get to the point of first deciding sort of the track that you wanted to pursue, and along the way, sort of the obstacles and the trials and the great things that happened as well, kind of along that way, your college life that got you.
Well, the flying thing was definitely the focus for me. For some reason, I figured out that I didn't want to be an airline pilot, though. I didn't want to necessarily fly for a living. I wanted my pilot's license, and I earned that right out of high school. I earned my private pilot's license, and I did that in a way. It was St. Pete Junior College at the time. It's now St. Petersburg College. They had this really great program. It was called Aviation Administration. And it was kind of a aviation business degree, but as part of it, you could earn your private pilot's license. And I knew that I could take classes that would roll right into my engineering degree program too, but I could earn a private pilot's license. I mean, why would you not want to do that? And so I hung around Clearwater for about a year and a half while I did that, and then ended up over at Embry-Riddle. Aeronautical engineering was what I chose to study there because that was the thing that seemed closest to me about how you would learn how things fly. And they also incorporated some, you know, jet and rocket engine classes and, you know, Kennedy Space Center is right down the road. And, you know, that seemed like the perfect place to go to school. And it was, and it's right on an airport. And everybody that's there loves flying in some way. You know, whatever degree program they're studying, there's some love of aviation and flight, you know, in it. So those were my people, I think. I think you need to find your people. And then while I was at KSC, we had a gentleman, one of my mentors, named Jay Honeycutt, who came in. He came in and kind of revamped the way we were doing things in the shuttle operations world. And part of what he saw was that there were a lot of these new young, back then young, engineers coming in straight out of college, not necessarily, you know, they've got all of the engineering classes, but they don't necessarily have the project management kind of thing to go along with it. And he worked with the University of Central Florida to develop, I mean, they basically crafted this degree program for the engineers out at KSC, which is called Engineering Management. And it's like a, I mean, it really was like an industrial engineering degree. So logistics and, you know, project management and things like that, which even though we were engineers out there, that is essentially what we were doing. We were working to get the vehicles out of the processing facility to the launch pad, then back off the runway into the, you know, to launch again. That's a project. And so while you had to understand the technical side of it, you also had to know how you move and integrate and work with all of the teams. And that, I think, you know, regardless of what degree, you know, if you're trying to be an astronaut, the bulk of our training as astronauts is how to work as a team, how to work as a crew. And so any experience you can get with that in school or the jobs you're doing will serve you really well. And that's whether you studied astrophysics or you're a medical doctor or you're an oceanographer or geophysicist, whatever it is, you can't just be independent in the books. You've got to be out in the real world and working with other people.
So you find yourself in the orbiter processing facilities. You're enjoying what you're doing. You're passionate about it. And then there's an opportunity to join one of the astronaut classes.
I wish it was that easy. You said, hey, there's this opportunity to join an astronaut class. Wouldn't that be awesome?
Tell us about how you became Nicole Stott, astronaut.
Well, like I said, I mean, it was a long time before I started thinking about astronaut as a job that I could even consider. And it's kind of weird because nobody ever told me I couldn't do it. I didn't have that going on. But it really, for myself, I think it was more of a self-confidence thing, maybe. Why is anything I've done, why would that be something that they would pick, you know, to be an astronaut? And so it really was. It was about, you know, nine or so years into the 10 and a half years I was working at Kennedy that I started looking at the astronauts that were coming through to fly on the missions that, you know, that I, along with that whole team there, were helping, you know, get the vehicles ready to support. And I started seeing that, you know, 99% of an astronaut's job is not flying in space. It's the job you're doing down on the ground. And then I started looking at the job they're doing down on the ground. I'm like, wow, that's a lot like the job I'm doing here at Kennedy, helping, you know, get these vehicles ready. And so it became more of something that seemed real to me than this mysterious, you know, thing that, oh my gosh, I could never possibly do that. But I think the clincher for me was reaching out to three people that I considered to be my mentors. Jay Honeycutt was one of those. Tip Talone, I don't know if you knew Tip Talone. And then one other that, you know, just saying, hey, does this seem like something I should even consider? And each of them had their own take on it. Very supportive, but the bottom line was, you know, Nicole, if you want to do this, you got to fill out the application. I mean, you just got to pick up the pen and fill out the application because nothing's going to happen if you don't do that You know, I can be your reference all day long, but unless you fill out the application, it's not going to happen. And so with their encouragement, I did that. I got an interview the first time I applied. I did not get selected, which I was not surprised. I mean, it didn't surprise me that that would happen. And even while I was going through the interview process, I'm like, you know what, Nikki, just enjoy this. Because you go through with like 15, 20 other people during this interview week, and I'm looking around me at all these super smart people that are doing cutting edge research and all this. I'm like, yeah, you know, you don't stand a chance, but you're meeting some really cool people and you're interviewing to be an astronaut, just go with it. So when I didn't get selected, it honestly didn't surprise me, but I enjoyed that whole experience.
Yeah.
And I ended up being fortunate in that they didn't want me that time, but they offered me a job at Johnson Space Center. And so I got to work for 2 years out at Ellington Field, flying as a flight engineer on the shuttle training aircraft. I don't remember that airplane. It's this modified G2 that, you know, it's modified in ways you would never want your airliner or, you know, airplane to be modified. You know, thrust reversers deploying in flight, so you could have this like 7 times the approach of a normal airliner like the shuttle does, and you're basically diving at the ground till 2,000 feet. And, I mean, awesome. You know, so for a person who loves to fly, loves airplanes, I'm like, yeah, you know, I didn't get picked to be an astronaut, but look what they're inviting me to go do. And so I got to work as a crew on that airplane. And while I was doing that, that offered me the opportunity to fly in T-38 jets, to fly on the Vomit Comet and go do some of those parabola flights to see what it would like, you know, be like to, you know, be in zero G. And really, really great experience. But the bottom line with that was they wanted to see how I would work, not as necessarily a crew getting a vehicle ready to fly, but how would I work as a crew member inside one of those vehicles. And those airplanes were the best way we had to look at that. And so 2 years later, I interviewed again and was selected. But it's funny because if you apply to be an astronaut and they offer you a job somewhere that's not astronaut, you go do that job. Because what they're doing is they're looking at you in another environment. There's something maybe in particular they want to see. And that was a beautiful thing, because most of the time you don't get any feedback at all, and you just apply again and hope that, you know, you get to interview again. And as it turns out, when I got selected, I came in, took that flight engineer job, and Steve Swanson went off to be an astronaut. He was selected in the 98 class. When I got chosen in 2000, Shane Kimbrough came in and took my spot as a flight engineer. So it was definitely one of those places that they used to see, you know, do we want this person or not?
All right, so you
I'm a rambler, sorry. You're never going to get a short answer
works out,
great out
for
of
us.
Me.
Yeah, yeah. This may not necessarily inspire the most rambling answer, but your first time feeling weightlessness, true weightlessness, first, do you remember it vividly? And two, were you able to keep everything down?
Yeah, the first time, maybe the fifth time, you know, in one of those airplanes. The first time was on the KC-135. We still have that airplane, and that's the plane we were flying for the microgravity research. And it is, it's like this roller coaster of flying. And yeah, you know, that's one of those, I do remember it. And it's like launching on a space shuttle. I think it's such a different experience that the first few seconds of it, you can't do anything but smile and high five and woohoo and all those kinds of things that just automatically come out of you when you do something like that. Highly recommend the shuttle launch version over the KC-135 thing. Although I do recommend if you get a chance to do one of those parabolic flights, you do it, and you just go with the hurling that will come if it does. Take the meds if they offer them, but there's a story of this reporter that got the chance to fly in like an F-18 or something, you know, and they went up and they did really aggressive maneuvers, and you know, the camera where they show the guy, you know, like he's passing out in the back and stuff. But apparently the guy got sick while he was flying, and as soon as they get on the ground, and he does not look good, but he's like, you know, thumbs up, and all, he's like, I blew, but I flew, you know. And I mean, I think that's just kind of the attitude you have to go with.
Absolutely. So we're kind of working our way slowly but surely through your career. And before you're able to go into space, before you're selected for one of the missions, you become an Aquanaut. And it is a mission, and so I'll have you define the NEMO mission for us. Mm-hmm. It is a mission that doesn't get as much fanfare, but seemingly has as much influence on the future of how humans are going to be working in space and working in close quarters and working, whether it's low Earth orbit, on the way to the moon or beyond. Tell us about your time as an Aquanaut.
So, I don't know if you're familiar, but right down the road from here, off the coast of Key Largo, is a habitat, an undersea habitat called Aquarius. And it's the only one like it on the planet. It's about the size of a school bus, sits at 60 feet underwater, and it's been there for a long time. It's gone through different hands and stuff in terms of the maintenance and care of it and things. But NASA, for the last, I would say, 15 years or so, has been doing missions there as we prepared crews to fly on the space station. And what I found was it was absolutely the best analog to flying in space that I experienced throughout my entire training. And that's because, you know, you're 60 feet underwater, you're living in this school bus. Once you're down there for an hour, you're not, you know, your body's saturated with nitrogen, you're not safely swimming to the surface anymore. So anything that goes wrong, you have to deal with it at 60 feet underwater, you know, either in or outside of this habitat. To go outside, you're not just going to go outside. You've got to put on special equipment to do that. So anytime we would go out on a dive, we treated that like a spacewalk, and we went through some of the same protocols you would do if you were going out on a spacewalk. And we did different kinds of surface exploration and research activities out, you know, in the water. And then inside the habitat itself, we did other experiments. You know, we did a lot of things. At the time, the NASA strategic plan was back to the moon. And so a lot of it was surface exploration, telerobotic surgery, you know, remote activities, those kinds of things. How are we going to support a crew on the moon, you know, and possibly further out on Mars if you can't have every different kind of person there at any given time? And so all of the research activities were part of a real mission. And it really was. It was the closest thing to living and working on the space station. And I did that before I flew. There are some astronauts who flew once and then come back and they go do a NEMO mission. And NEMO, you know, like NASA has really wants an acronym for everything. And so NEMO, it's with two E's, stands for the NASA Extreme Environment Mission Operations. And so I was on the NEMO 9 crew, which was the ninth one of those missions. And we very fortunately had the longest mission to date. So we were down there for 18 days. And before coming up, and it's kind of what I remember about before coming home from space, mm-hmm. too, you know, sitting at this little table in the galley with this, you know, this big porthole there, you know, you're looking out at this pristine, brief and sea life around you and this whole inner space kind of place. And I remember thinking, you know, if I never get to fly in space, you know, which there's no guarantee you're going to get to do that. So, man, if I never get to fly in space, this was the coolest kind of adventure thing I have ever done. And I think, just like flying in space, the reason why it ends up being so cool is that it's providing you with a perspective on where we live that's so totally different to what, you know, we're normally engaging in. And both the underwater and the in-space thing to me, ultimately, the thing I took away from it is that every day we should be looking around, you know, just even here, you know, what is it about the things and the people that are surrounding us that are really, really incredible? And trying to take that perspective out of something that you experience every day without having to go to space or having to go live underwater. And there are opportunities for that, I think, everywhere we look.
So that's 2006, correct?
2006, yes.
All right, so 2009 comes around. And there is a shuttle mission, STS-128. Mm-hmm. What do those numbers mean to you?
They're the lead-in to the woohoo, high five, and the, you know, the smile on the face. Absolutely. I think any of the mission experience that I had, any of the time working at Kennedy, underwater, I mean, all of it ultimately, and there's a picture of us with our clown noses on in the, you know, in the slideshow up here, but it all comes down to the, you know, the people that you share it with. And so when I think of STS-128, I think of the, you know, the six people that I shared that flight with, or you know, the five other people, the people I was going to join on the space station, you know, all the people that helped me get ready on the ground, the people that strapped me in before I lifted off. I mean, that really is what it comes down to me. And all of those experiences is, you know, is the people you get to share it with. And thankfully, you don't fly in space alone either, because you know, there's so many things you're seeing out the window or feeling when you're floating or doing that, you just want to grab somebody and ask them if that happened to them yet or or what is that?
All right. Now, 128 is the mission that brings you to the space station. And you spent a little over 90 days on the space station. Tell us about your time in the one of the single most impressive pieces of human handiwork ever.
And I agree. I think the word I like to use is masterpiece, you know, because, and I think when you look at the space station just kind of hanging in space, it really, it's like a work of art. I mean, you look at it and it's just incredibly beautiful to see. But then at the same time, you're like, wow, this is, from a technical standpoint, one of, if not the most complex things that we've ever done as human beings. And that's not just, you know, an engineering team here in the U.S., but from all over the world, you know, working together peacefully, successfully to do that. And then once we got it all together, it's like now we've got crews of six living on this vehicle, crews from all over the world, one crew. It's not like the Russian crew is down in the Russian segment and we let, you know, the Japanese guy only gets to go in the Japanese module and, you know, thou shalt not cross the hatch. I mean, you are one crew on, you know, this International Space Station. And this is a little off of your question, but it's absolutely the best example of how we should be doing stuff down here on Earth. You know, everything that we do as ground teams to make that happen, everything we're doing as an integrated crew working in space to, you know, do the research and the maintenance and the outreach that happens up there is this beautiful example of how we should be doing things down here. So I'll get off that soapbox for the moment. But the, you know, one of the best things about living in space now on the space station, and there's a lot of them, but is that there is absolutely no day that is the same. Every day is a mix of science and maintenance and talking to the ground or, you know, doing media outreach or with schools or whatever it is, but every day is different. And every job is the job of every astronaut. So you are absolutely jack of all trades. And that's really fun. You know, to have this opportunity to be doing science and then to be fixing the toilet or, you know, or a spacewalk or talking to kids, you know, in Idaho or, you know, or Germany or wherever and sharing the experience and floating from one end of the station to another. I cannot overstate the coolness, the just liberating feeling of being able to float and fly like that. Really, really great.
And then, of course, you were a crew member on STS-133, which was the final launch and landing of Discovery, mm-hmm. and spent a little under 13 days in space. One of the things that stands out to me about that, and especially when we are able to talk to a female astronaut, is that you're on a crew that is entirely male, with the exception of you. In terms of working in that sort of team dynamic, can you speak to the pros and the cons on something like that, especially given the sense that, you know, here on Earth, having a team that might be that lopsided in one gender or the other can lead to issues. So, yeah.
Well, for the spaceflight crews that I was on, there never was an issue with it. And I don't know if the space program is more progressive than other places or not. I'm not sure. I feel blessed to have worked almost my whole life in that environment. And yeah, you know, both of my flights, I was the only woman on the crew. But honestly, I never thought about it unless I got asked the question about it, which I think is a good thing. You know, I never thought about it unless somebody said, hey, what's it like to be the only woman on the crew? What's it like to be a mother? You know, how could you be a mother and go fly in space, go strap on a rocket, you know, and launch into space? And I look at my five crewmates and I'm like, these guys are all dads. I think they probably, you know, love their kids as much as, you know, and there's that same kind of, you know, you have parental bond perhaps, but, you know, mother somehow, you know, stands out a little differently. So I never, And I think I never thought about it because it was never in my face like, okay, Nicole, you're the only woman on this crew and you're not as good. At, you know, I mean, I never had that sense. I never felt like I was being patronized in any way. I never felt like I was the token one woman on the crew. I never was treated. And I will say, I honestly thought that in some of the other countries, that might be a thing where there might have been a little imbalance in how I was treated versus my male crewmates, and I never felt that. And the thing I will say too, that I think I would love to see more women flying in space, and we're getting there. Our last class of US astronauts, 12 people, 5 were women. The class before was 8 people, 4 women. I would say that the balance in the office right now is getting close to 40% women in the US astronaut office, which is huge. That's a much larger number than what you'll typically see in engineering schools for the female population.
This was brought up last night at the Women in STEM panel, is that at the upper levels of both academics and engineering, the numbers are between 10 and 20%.
If you can get 20%, you know, female enrollment within an engineering, just looking at engineering, I mean, you're like, woo, you know? And so I'm looking at these two young ladies down here because there's this, you know, there's new, different kinds of ideas that we can put in play to encourage women to just go for it. And like I was saying to them too, is we had a really nice conversation. It was like, you know, whether you're a scientist looking through a microscope or you're a pilot flying an airplane or you're on a rocket ship, those things don't care if you're a boy or a girl. You know, it's only us doing it to each other, you know, making these distinctions that are completely irrelevant. You know, the airplane doesn't care if you're a boy or girl. It just wants you to fly it the way it's supposed to be flown, you know, because it wants to make it back to the ground, too. We'll give it a little brain or something. You know, I mean, it would like to make it back to the ground safely, too. But, and then I look at, the teams I was working with on the ground. Oh, my gosh, you know, you look at the control center for the space station. You know, those little bird's eye views they give you on NASA TV all the time. You know, it's just this blend of men and women working in there from all over. There's no way to go in there and say, oh, well, there's only 2 women in the control center. That's just not the way it is. And the training community is the same way. You know, even when I worked at KSC, the technician workforce on the floor that would do in the real work on the vehicles, beautiful mix of men and women doing that. So maybe there's a lot of opportunity for other industry or academia to learn from what we've done in the space program from that standpoint too.
Well, let's let you go a little bit forward on that. Given your experience at KSC and in the astronaut corps and in space, what do you think we can take from those environments to put in other environments, whether it's academics or it's private sector engineering or it's getting girls and young women to stick in the STEM fields and to build the rockets and hopefully someday get in them too and visit other worlds? What do you think we can take from what you've experienced and how do we better equip those other industries, those other disciplines to be able to help them get that sort of parity?
Well, I think in the space industry in general, whether you're an astronaut flying in space or you're working in mission control or you're designing the vehicles or building them, whatever, the population is good. That blend is already there. So we could just in general use that as an example. I think for young girls, there's a need to get women who are doing these jobs out there, you know, visible, present to them. I have a 15-year-old son, and I've watched the whole time he's grown up. And I can tell you, he and his, you know, his male friends, they don't, when they're looking at it, you know, somebody on stage that's an example, or if they're looking on TV or whatever, they don't care if it's a man or woman. I mean, there's this general, I hate to stereotype, but there's this general sense that boys just, they're not looking at it as boy-girl that's showing them what to do. Girls, I think, really need to see women doing these things. And, you know, hopefully we'll get to the point where that doesn't matter either. But so I think, you know, I feel an obligation to be present and get out there and, you know, show young women that, you know, and I'm a person who didn't have the confidence in myself until I almost was ineligible to fill out the application. So I like to encourage people to even consider that. What else? Let's see. Yeah, there's something else.
I guarantee it's something we'll end up coming back to with the audience. And so now, of course, we will start opening it to audience.
All right, I remember. Because we were going to open it to you guys, now I have to interrupt you. The other thing is, what's so great about the space program, and that's whether you're an engineer, a technician, a developer, an astronaut, is that, and it's what I find now, is I can be asked by a kindergarten class, or I can be asked by a senior leadership team at Johnson & Johnson. I mean, and when they asked me, I was like, really? What am I going to say to these people? But what we're doing in the space program, in every aspect of it, and, for me, I use training to fly in space, working as an engineer, actually flying in space, those kinds of things is my, my base for my communication. But you can take that whole thing and morph it into a story or a message that's relevant to any of those, any of those audiences. And it's great to have that kind of material that's easy to, to shift into something like that, to be able to say, here's the things I learned from, whether it's leadership or followership or teaming, to a senior leadership team that's trying to do something different at Johnson & Johnson, to kids in a kindergarten class. And it's nice to have that kind of material to work with. And I think the space program just lends itself to that.
Fantastic. All right, so I'm going to leave most of the questions about your experiences in space to the audience.
Okay.
But there is one question I need to get. What was your favorite place on Earth to orbit over?
You've probably been seeing a lot in these images, and we're in it. Florida, and I say that because, first of all, Florida was where I grew up. So Florida, I considered Florida to be home. I consider it to be home now, too. I'm so happy to be back in Florida. Houston, the people are great. But when I got to space, looking out the window, if I knew we were flying over Florida, I wanted to get to the window and see Florida. And I think it's because I wanted to see something familiar to me. And we do that a lot of times. We go into a room with 20 people and you're looking for the person you know first. And so I was doing that, looking out the window. And then looking out the window kind of evolved over time. It went from Florida to, oh, look, Florida with respect to the whole Caribbean, which, by the way, in short answer to the question is, the whole expanse of Earth from the southern tip of Florida down to the northern coast of Venezuela, absolutely the most beautiful place on the planet. But you look out the window and it is an evolution of Florida, familiar, wacky things like your friend crawling along the bottom of the space station and get your brain to wrap around why Al's not falling, 250 miles down to Earth and knowing that he feels like he's just crawling along the ground and, seeing the solar arrays against, one of those 16 times a day sunrises mm-hmm. or sunsets that you get, and then learning the geography of Earth just by looking out. There is no better classroom for geography than, looking it out the window of your space shuttle or space station. And then really just having it turn into, some of these places. There's Florida. Look at that. Is that not gorgeous? But then just having it get to the point where it's like, I don't care where it is on Earth, but what am I going to be surprised by when I look out the window? Almost like Earth as a work of art. And very quickly, Earth becomes home versus just Florida being home. And that's that perspective thing, I think, that's important that we take advantage of down here on Earth as well. Maybe once a day think about the fact that we live on a planet, mm-hmm. that kind of thing.
So Earth as a work of art.
Mm-hmm.
The best possible segue into, it seems like anybody can be an astronaut.
Anybody.
But not everybody can be the artist astronaut. And of course we have a few pieces of your art here on stage. We get to rewind back. What inspires you as an artist, as a young artist, as a young woman, a woman going through the technical side of college and engineering, working with the shuttles, to then be sitting on the space station and to do your art in a way that allows you to inspire other people. So I guess this is the question for all artists. What inspires you to be an artist?
Well, I think, you know, you mentioned like, you know, working as an engineer, you know, on the space shuttle, on the space station, and with other engineers or technical people. What I've found over the 28 years I worked for NASA is that most of those people that you think of as only technical, science, engineering, astronaut, whatever, have a really nice balance of tech and creativity in their lives somehow. You know, whether they're painters or dancers or, you know, they build, you know, woodworking, whatever it is, there's, you know, musicians, there's something in their life that is creative as well. I think it's much less likely now, especially, to find, you know, a person who's an engineer, only thinks of the ones and zeros. You know, there's that's a rarity, I believe. I did a whole art show with my colleagues by pulling in their creative side too, and saying, "Show me what you do artistically, and tell me about how science and art have intersected in your lives." For me, it's just always kind of been there. And when I was asked what personal items would I want to take to the space station with me, maybe I'll paint in space. And at the time, I had no clue nobody else had painted in space. Why would nobody else have painted in space? I mean, it just seems like, you know, there's a keyboard and a guitar and a flute on the space station. Chell Lindgren, a couple years ago, played the first set of bagpipes on the space station. You got to have real patience with your crewmates if they're going to play bagpipes in space. But he did, and my classmate Karen Nyberg, probably the most wonderful artist I know, I mean, in all areas, she quilted in space, quilt squares, made a little stuffed animal for her son up there, you know, so more and more people are bringing it to space with them, too. Typically, you'd think of photography as the artistic outlet for astronauts, and most astronauts who even may not have been photographers before, you know, when you stick your face in that window, you want to take a picture of it too, so you remember it. But painting in space was a really special experience. I wish I had more than just the one picture that Bob Thirsk took of me painting in space, but, you know, do over maybe sometime. And it was special from being in that environment and the way water works and the way painting was and everything. And, you know, you can't sit in front of the window and paint what you see out the window, because at 5 miles a second, that's not going to be there anymore. So you got to take a picture of it and paint it. But when you look out that window, that if you're not inspired to paint or take a picture of it or just sit there and absorb it, there's something wrong with you. I mean, really. And when I started thinking about retiring from NASA, moving on to whatever that next adventure was going to be after astronaut, which was a difficult decision to make, but once I did, I really felt like I needed a unique way to share what I had experienced. And I just kept coming back to that painting. And I knew I was going to continue painting myself anyway, and why not have those views I had out the window or of the spacecraft be my inspiration and be the way that I could share maybe with audiences don't even know we have a space station, because there are those people out there. Let me just tell you, there's a lot of them that don't even know we have a space station. And if I can get them engaged through art to let them know that, you know, for the last 17 years, continuously, there have been people living off our planet, going around it 16 times a day, then that's a good thing. And art is, I think, a universal kind of communicator that allows you to speak with people that might not be thinking about what we're doing in space that's all about improving life here on Earth.
So you worked primarily with watercolor. Mm-hmm. Speak to the technical issues that might come from working with watercolors in microgravity. Eating, using the restroom, yeah, sleeping, all of these things are affected by it. I can't imagine it's the easiest thing easiest thing in orbit for you to be able to do.
You know, it wasn't difficult. It was like most things in space. You've got to look at it, or in microgravity, I guess. You have to think of everything as part of the adventure, really. And that is, you know, going to the bathroom, how you're going to type on your computer, the way you sleep, eating, all of that. It's part of the adventure. And thankfully, it's different, you know? And it's a really beautiful part of it. Painting in space, I mean, I took watercolors. I'm glad I took watercolors. I think acrylics would have been really messy. And not so much from the painting side of it, but from the cleanup and, you know, that kind of side of it, it would have been messy. But the watercolors were really fun because, and I was telling a group, you know, the group that we were talking earlier, that it was, I wish I had a videotape. I wish I had videotaped it, because I think in that one experience of painting in space, I could have described all of why we go to space. You know, why do we go to a place where we take gravity out of the equation to begin with? What are we learning from doing that? Things behave differently. We learn stuff we never even thought we'd learn about things we thought we knew everything about already. So I did that same thing with painting. But you squirt a little ball of water out of your drink bag, and most of it's just about keeping track of your stuff and not squirting the bag like crazy all over the place, which, you know, we were talking Jackson Pollock earlier too. You know, that would be fun in a glove box, just let it go. Or have it, Rocket Man, one of my favorite space movies. Everybody seen the movie Rocket Man? Oh, come on, yes. Leave and go watch it, it's hysterical. So they're going to Mars, and there's this scene where the guy who ends up not being, you know, in the sleep for the trip to Mars uses all the food and everything and does this, you know, thing, Sistine Chapel thing on the top of the vehicle. But that would be fun. But yeah, so you keep control of your water, you got your ball of water, your brush touches it, you know, it floats around the end of the brush, you mush that into the colors, and it's like everything you wanted to transfer the water to wanted to go to that place, like more than you would expect it to. Just kind of floated off the brush into the paint, and then off the paint back into the brush, and the biggest thing with it really was once you did start to apply it to the paper, you had to be, you know, really careful with how you, it was almost like you were painting, and there was this like colored water like being dragged along the paper versus the brush pushing along the paper. Because if you push the brush onto the paper, then all of that paint and water would go into it, and then, you know, it wouldn't make what you wanted it to make. And this is the painting that I did in space. You know, it's not, there's nothing fancy or probably all that great about it, but and I think the picture is in this slideshow. In that little expanse of area between the southern tip of Florida and Venezuela is a little chain of islands called Las Rocas. And I remember I picked that picture to paint because I remember looking out the window and just the surprise of that moment looking out the window was, wow, it looks like somebody had painted a wave on the ocean. And that's the way the little chain, and it's a tiny little chain of islands, kind of, if you're familiar with Aruba, Curacao, Bonaire, 50 miles east of Bonaire is this Venezuelan chain of islands called Las Rocas. And it does. It looks like somebody had already painted a wave on the ocean.
All right. So with every artist, you're given the opportunity to define who you are as an artist by what you go and present. And so I know we've got your space painting. But we have a few other works of art up here on stage. That's a little bit of background. really on why you chose them and what they mean in terms of helping to define who you are as an artist.
Well, people want to see the one I painted in space, so I brought that tonight. But like the two that are behind me, when I started painting, you know, to try to reflect the experience in space, two things came to mind. And my husband is actually the one who came up, and there's nothing really all that fancy about these names or anything, but like an Earth observation collection and a spacecraft collection. So this painting over here is inspired by a picture of the Bahamas that I took. There's this beautiful area of the Bahamas you might have heard of called the Tongue of the Ocean. It's this really deep blue, you know, area, and it looks like a tongue, like the shape of a tongue between the islands. And then you have these beautiful turquoises and other blues and the white clouds and everything all around that. And those Bahama pictures I've used for quite a few things, you know, to paint, you know, to be inspired by. That painting in particular, the colors, if you look at it, the paint that I chose, while I like painting with watercolors, I don't think watercolor captures what I remember Earth looking like when I looked out the window. So when you look at Earth from space, and the pictures, you know, and videos are beautiful that are being taken. I mean, the cameras are so much better now than they were back in the olden days in 2009 and 2011, you know. But they're stunning, but they still, you know, it's just like, you know, when you experience something here on Earth in person, what you see with your eye, you know, what you feel with your heart is different than what comes out in the picture. And the same thing is true of the imagery from space. And so when I was painting, you know, when I'm painting now, I wanted to find paints that, to me, in the best way possible, look like what I remember Earth looking like. And Earth just glows. I mean, it glows in all of those colors that we know Earth to be. But it's like somebody took a light bulb and just splattered all those Earth colors on it and turned it on. It's almost blinding. And so there's this iridescence kind of translucence to it that I wanted to find in the paints. And so the paints in there are the ones that I use. And unfortunately, they're an oil-based paint. So it's a little bit messier down here to, you know, to paint with. But they're the best I could find so far. And so that's kind of what's in that Bahamas painting. And then this one is part of the spacecraft collection. And I didn't take that picture, but my crewmate, Danny Olivas, we were out on a 6.5 hour spacewalk. And I have a picture that was taken of me like that I used for the inspiration for it. And what I tried to do in this one was, you know, capture that, you know, memory for myself, but more, it almost, to me, when I look at it, it almost doesn't look finished. I mean, it kind of looks childish, you know, in it. And the pinks and some of the colors aren't what you will see in the picture itself. But spacewalking is absolute, I mean, you know, flying in space is a surreal experience. Spacewalking is at like the top of the surreal list. You know, to be out there in your own spacesuit, you know, really your own spaceship, everything you need to survive is in this little, you know, outfit that you're wearing, and you're tethering, you know, making sure you're clipped on to the station all the time you're moving around, and, you know, being more alone than I have ever felt. I mean, really, more alone, isolated, but then at the same time, more connected to, you know, Danny, who was out there, my crewmates inside, the ground team, you know, really feeling that connection too. It really was like a dream. I mean, I am so thankful for the pictures and videos of spacewalking, because there's only like moments of it that I really remember. And so I want that, that to me is supposed to be like, you know, spacewalk is kind of like this dream, you know, the reflections in that helmet aren't right. I mean, I meant them to not be there and to put fake colors into it and stuff. So that's that. And this is a spacesuit called Hope. And, you know, I'm trying to make these long stories short. I'm not doing a very good job. So I've been working on this thing called the Spacesuit Art Project. And, you know, I flew in space, really blessed to fly in space. I believe in all the work that we're doing up there. I think it is all important work. We need to continue doing it. We need to be building more spaceships and flying more people in space, all of that. But in the end, kind of like the, you know, the connection to the people that you make, is, you know, that being the important thing that goes along with the mission, is I really think now that I did all those things in space, had that opportunity, so that I'm in a position to get invited to participate in projects like this. And this is a project where we've been painting with kids that are in treatment at pediatric cancer centers, and we started in Houston at MD Anderson, and every little square on this spacesuit is one of these children's paintings. And then our spacesuit company, ILC Dover, volunteered, and they quilted all of those paintings together into this spacesuit. And the first one's called Hope, and that was just MD Anderson kids. The second one was called Courage, and we kind of were scheming when we did Courage. And it's a, you know, like the T-38 flight suits or the military flight suits. We wanted to be able to get something up to space station, and we didn't think they'd let us fly something like this. We thought, oh, that won't pack up small enough to, you know, to get up there. So, you know, maybe we have the kids paint right on a flight suit, and then we can pack that really small. And there's this, you know, there's open space sometimes on the cargo vehicles, like allotments for special, you know, other things, not just payloads and stuff. And we thought, well, maybe we can get in on some of that. And so we did this suit called Courage with the kids from MD Anderson again, and it flew to station, and Kate Rubens wore it while she was on station, and we did a video conference with the kids at Mission Control, you know, that had painted on the suit. It was really great. So we had hope and courage. And then ILC Dover volunteered to do another suit if we wanted to. And so we wanted to model it after these relationships that we have with our international partners on the station program. And so we went and we painted with kids and hospitals at all of our station partner countries. And I brought in my astronaut and cosmonaut friends to come paint with us. And so we had paintings from Japan and Russia and Germany and Canada and where else? The US, is that it? Whatever. Pardon me? Well, Germany was our Europe, and actually, you know, and so we had a, you know, a mix of the European astronauts there, but we went to Cologne, where their headquarters is, for the European Astronaut Center. And so we had all these kids from all over the world that painted, and then they built another suit like this called Unity. And that one, we got to fly to station two. And they offered to fly that one. I was really, I mean, you know, thankful, knocking on wood, all this stuff. Really, really fortunate to have this happen. And then Jack Fisher wore that on station, and the whole crew did a video conference with us, and we did this global video conference with the kids all over the world to communicate with them like that. And so the whole thing has just been tying the inspiration of space and using art and this idea of art and healing and art and wellness, which applies not only to kids in, you know, a cancer treatment center where, you know, they're, you know, going through what I hope will be the most challenging thing they go through in their life, but it applies to astronauts flying in space too. You know, if we're gonna send astronauts further and further off of Earth to Mars, to where you don't see, you know, get to see that beauty of Earth out the window anymore, you know, art and things like it are gonna be the, you know, the kind of the psychological tools that we use to manage that 9 months or whatever it is to get to Mars at this point.
So, hypothetical art question. You get to go back into orbit without any of the problems going with it, and you get to create any sort of art that you want. What would it be?
I think I'd probably paint again. I think I'd make the time to paint more. It's weird, you know. I remember before flying on station, we used to, in the office, people who had flown, they're like, "Oh, shuttle missions are like a sprint, you know, and station missions are like a marathon." And from the time, overall time standpoint, that's true. You know, you got 2 weeks on a shuttle mission, got to get a, you know, get a lot of stuff done in that 2 weeks. But I can tell you what, that 3 months I was on station, you're getting a lot done. You know, your days are busy, you're working a lot. And so I am so thankful I even found the time to paint once while I was up there. I think what I'd like to try would be to not just paint what I was seeing out the window, but to paint some of the experiences that we were having as a crew inside the station too. All
right. So then what we'll do is segue, and now for those of you who'd like to ask questions of Nicole, we have two microphones on either side. Feel free to get to those, and we'll try to take questions as quickly as possible. But you retired from the NASA Astronaut Corps in 2015, and you know, I guess if we're doing astronaut artists, we're going to keep with the alliteration. Now, as an advocate and an activist, what takes up your time now? What inspires you every day when you wake up in the morning?
Well, I like to find time to paint because, you know, there's, just like looking out the window of the space station, there's kind of a transcendent, you know, meditative, you know, restorative aspect of it. And, I mean, maybe that sounds a little weird, but it really is. It's something that kind of grounds me now, gets me thinking a little bit more clearly about what I want to do the rest of the day or what I've got coming up in the, you know, in the week or months ahead. I love doing stuff like this. I mean, I like the opportunity to just get out and be able to just, and I love the name of this event, you know, to have a conversation with people about the experience and hopefully share it in a way that, you know, other people get something out of it that they might not have thought they would get out of it. That's important to me. I am continuing to work on the spacesuit art project. We're looking at, we've really worked hard to facilitate art and medicine programs at hospitals around the world. We want to continue to do that. And we also want to support research for, you know, research into the study of how does art and things like that you know, substantively, quantitatively improve, you know, people's lives, improve the life of a child who's, you know, going through cancer treatment, or somebody who just doesn't feel like getting out of bed in the morning, or an astronaut that's flying for 9 months, you know, in space. And, you know, try to look at how we can extend that. And what's been beautiful about this project is there's all kinds of other things coming from it that are spin-offs, just like what NASA does. You know, there's these spin-off things. And I think that'll be a big part of what I do. And then I'm a huge ocean advocate, you know, in terms of ocean conservation, both from the ocean itself as well as the creatures that live there. So kind of the earth and earthling thing is important to me too.
Very cool. So of course now we're gonna move on to both audience and online questions. Now it's a free-for-all, so who knows what we're gonna get. But we're gonna start over here with you, Miss. Please go on ahead and thank you for coming out tonight.
Karaoke. No, karaoke, I suppose. Yeah. What's your song? I disagree.
That is the biggest shock of the evening, I tell you.
Yeah, you don't even waste your time on that. Yeah.
And then my second question is, how did you become an aquanaut?
How did I become an aquanaut? Well, I got really lucky, I think, that NASA was using that kind of training to prepare us to fly in space. And so, And like I said, the best preparation, I think, overall for what it's like to live and work in space. And I'll tell you, if you get a chance to go down to Key Largo, Florida International University is the ones who maintain that facility now. They have a topside facility where they do all of the coordination of the missions and everything. And they are, you know, open to people coming and touring and seeing what they do. You can't necessarily get in the water and go down to Aquarius, but if you talk to them, there might be ways, you know, in the future to be able to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Over here.
Hi. So, with gravitational lensing, could you see anything happening with the moon when it would go under the horizon? Would it stretch or compress as it went down?
It was really cool to watch the moon, you know, like a moon rise and set. And you know when you go out to the beach, you know, like go over to Clearwater Beach and you watch a sunset and the sun looks like it kind of squishes down into the water? The same thing happens with the moon. And depending on kind of the phase of the moon, it looks different. And if you get kind of this, haze isn't the word, but it almost looks like the haze of the atmosphere. It looks, and there, I think there's a picture in this slideshow too that kind of shows one of those phases of that, or you know, the part of that setting action going on.
Yeah, there's a picture of the sun doing that, but I didn't see. I don't think there's one of the moon.
I don't know if there is or not, but that it is. It's such a great thing to track. You know, like to take a whole moon set, and a lot of the guys recently have done some video, like time lapse video sequences of the moon rising and setting, and it's stunning because it shocks you at first. The moon. You know, we're not that much closer to the moon on the space station. What are we, 250 miles up? You know, that in a 250,000 mile kind of thing, that's not that big a deal. But it looks different. It looks clearer. It looks round. You know, it looks more spherical. It looks bigger for some reason, even though it really isn't that much bigger when you're there. But when you watch it setting, it really does. It does this kind of squishing thing. And then all of a sudden it's gone. You're like, where'd that go? Kind of like the sun setting into the Gulf. Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, so we've got a question from online. Mm-hmm. This is from Todd. How would you define a successful career as an astronaut?
Wow. Wow. Well, I think as astronaut, you would want to have flown in space. You know, in the grand scheme of things, I don't know that that would really be the most important thing. But if you're fortunate enough as an astronaut to fly in space, I think if you go to space and work, you know, peacefully, successfully with your crew, and st- still talk to each other when you get back? And I say that, I don't mean that like, oh my gosh, you're gonna get up there and there's no, you know, you're gonna be pulling each other's hair out and stuff. It was so cool to me to work with these guys on the ground. And on the ground, and we should be doing these things with our families too. You know, I've talked to my husband sometime, like, you know, maybe if we did some of the stuff sometimes that we did in training, you know, the whole family thing is, you know, we kind of let that go freewheeling. But we figured out before we flew how we would deal with somebody not having a good day. And we did that when we got to space. You know, if Frank woke up and just was not in a good mood that day, you knew. And you knew how to deal with Frank, and Frank would let you know if it was more than that. And the same thing was true about, you know, an emergency alarm going off and watching the whole crew rally in a way that we train, you know, just like we trained on the ground. And everybody doing what you would expect them to do, and enjoying, you know, enjoying the time and space, and, you know, it's kind of the simplistic part of it more than, and I think that's true in most things too. All right.
Yes, over there.
What was it like in space?
It was awesome in space. So I want you one thing just to imagine, like imagine that you could just push with your fingertip off of the floor and then just float over all the way over to that other side of the auditorium, but not on the ground, but like way up in the corner over there. That would be awesome. I highly recommend it. Yeah, everything about it was, everything about the time and space was better than I expected, and I had really high positive expectations what it would be like. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you. And then we're actually going to stick to the side. So, Miss, you can go on ahead of yourself.
How long did it take you? How long did it take you to learn how to paint in space so well?
To learn how to paint in space so well? Why, thank you. you know, I had painted on the ground before, so, and really, the art I do is experimental all the time. I don't have any formal art training at all, so it's been really fun just to kind of play with it, really. And when I painted in space, I kind of went into it with that idea that, wow, this is just gonna be something fun to do that is different than how you do it on Earth, and if it ends up being pretty great, if not, it's just fun. And that was true about a lot of things in space, actually.
I've been looking at all your paintings and they're really, really good.
Thank you. I like you.
She can get you into space.
Thank you
maybe.
Very much.
Awesome. Thank you so much. All right, over here on our right.
Hello, my name is Patrick Joyner Tolentino, astrophysicist, mathematician.
Sure, no pressure here now, right? How do you go to the bathroom in the space? Is that your question? Yeah.
No, I know how that works. My question more along the lines, because I also want to be an astronaut and the first person to go to Mars. What are the good stepping stones for that? Like right now I study physics and mathematics, and I plan on getting my PhD in astrophysics, studying stellar dynamics and planetary and solar interactions with one another. So after I get my PhD, what are my next stepping stones? So how would you plot a career from college student that wants to be an astronaut to going to Mars?
Well, you know, the sad answer is, or maybe the disappointing answer is, that there's no checklist. I mean, really. NASA has some very basic requirements, you know, education requirements, you know, early career requirements, of which, you know, a PhD equates to so many years in the workforce kind of thing, and then, you know, some medical requirements. And so there's, you know, I wish I could just give you the recipe, but I think the key to it, really, and hopefully you've been doing this already with everything you've studied, is that you like what you're studying. That you enjoy it, that that the next class you want to take is something because, you know, it's extending on what you've already done and will help you, you know, learn, be curious about other things you're excited about. And that is where I think the real opportunities open up, is if you're paying attention to what you enjoy and going after that, the opportunities open up. There's only very basic requirements that you have to satisfy. And I don't know if the picture is in the slideshow or not. I have this picture that I usually show of my astronaut class, and we're all wearing these goofy, you know, bug antenna and these sunglasses. And It was from the day when we took our first class, or our class picture. You know, we have the formal NASA one where you're sitting up straight, but then there's the goofy bug one, because our class name is the Bugs. And I show it because there's 17 people in that picture. All of us at some point said, hey, astronaut would be a cool thing to do. All 17 of us got to that place in very different, and every one of us had a different way of getting there. But the common thing was that we were all doing something we really enjoyed before we got selected. And I think that's the main thing. You know, in that class, we had oceanographer, geophysicists, medical doctors, fighter pilots, engineers. I mean, you know, everything you can imagine. But and on top of that, you know, artists, musicians, race car drivers, you know, all of that, which, you know, when you go to assign a crew of six, makes for a really nice mix of people, and you're probably going to be more successful because you've got different strengths to leverage. But in the end, it's all about paying attention to what you enjoy. Sounds like you already got the education thing down, you know. You don't have to worry about that. I wish there was, you know, in some ways I wish there was a checklist I could give you though too, but just go for what you enjoy doing.
Thank you. All right, go ahead.
What was your favorite thing you did in space?
Everything. That is such a hard question. It really is, because everything about it was special in some way. I mean, really, I loved talking to my son on the phone from space. You know, just to say that, hey, I just called you from space. You know, add from space or in space to the end of whatever it is. And it's great, you know, floating, flying, to be able to move, you know, in three dimensions and just know how you're going to get around by pushing, you know, softly off the wall, or looking, you know, sharing that view out the window with, you know, with your crewmates, or doing goofy astronaut tricks and food and, I mean, all of it, everything about it, it's like one big moment all wrapped up into my favorite moment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, you over here.
How would you get food in space?
How
would you get food on the ISS?
How do you get food to the ISS? Well, food is a big system. A lot of logistics associated with getting food to space. So we have cargo vehicles. We used to be able to take food up on the space shuttle, and then the Russians have something called a Progress, which is a cargo vehicle, and SpaceX right down the road has a Dragon cargo vehicle, and Orbital with the Cygnus cargo vehicle. And you know, it's all about just having a vehicle to transport the food to space. And the thing is, we are growing some things in space now, but not growing enough that you could just live off of that. So most of the food is prepackaged, like camping food. You know, you have to add water to it to get it in the form that you could eat it. A lot of it's like what the military uses, which is prepackaged stuff that's ready to eat right out of the bag. You just have to heat it up. But most of it is dehydrated, and you have to add water to it. But eating in space is really fun. I mean, eating in space is really fun. It's the food up there is really quite good. There's food from all the different countries provide food now to the space station. So, you know, two nights a week, I think I really loved the Japanese curries, like the chicken curry that they sent was delicious, and the Russian soups and cereals, and we sent up, you know, Stouffer's macaroni and cheese was pretty good. M&Ms, although you can't call them M&Ms because then you would be advertising for M&Ms. So you have to call them chocolate coated or candy coated chocolates. But eating in space is fun, and you really only need a long spoon. Didn't use forks much at all, but you never wanted to lose your long spoon because you had to scoop down into a bag and get your food out. Food would stick to your spoon. You could float it around. We didn't eat bread. We didn't eat bread in space because bread's really crumbly, or crackers because they're really crumbly. Because you can imagine if you had a bunch of potato chips or crumbly bread and all that got into the air and floated around, it could get into your equipment, which wouldn't be good. But you could also end up breathing it in or getting it in your eyes, and that would be bad. So we would use tortillas. Tortillas was the bread in space.
It's not every day you can get a pneumonia from crackers.
Yeah, so really, or put an eye out from a cracker. Yeah.
Thank you. All right, we're going to go back over here. So,
Hi, I have two questions. My first one is, what are your thoughts on the Mars One project and its pros, cons, complications, possibilities, etc.?
Mars One, I think if, you know, there may have been a little bit of misrepresentation with Mars One. You know, we're going to go there and die was kind of the, you know, there wasn't going to be any infrastructure in place and all that. But I think if you talk to the people that are signed up to do Mars One, they're like, no, really? Is that what it's all about? You know, that's not the intention. I don't know if that'll come to reality or not at all. I don't know. But what I love about it is that there are people really excited about the possibility, you know, about the possibilities both on and off our planet. And looking at how, you know, we don't just explore other places, but we go and find, you know, other places for humanity to survive. And when I think about going back to the moon, going on to Mars, whether it's Mars One or, you know, a NASA Mars mission or Elon taking, you know, however many thousands of people at one time there, to me it's ultimately about improving life here on Earth. And, you know, something about it is going to be about improving life here on Earth. And that to me is what's so cool about it.
Thank you. I have one more question. You come from an era that was slightly before me, so back in your era.
What?
Well, I mean, I grew up.
You could say you're old, and I'm not.
I mean, my early ages were in the 90s, but you grew up during the 80s, and when space was really getting started, and when astronauts were hailed as national heroes, you know, there was really a different perspective towards what space exploration was. And do you think the lack of passion in the national sense towards space exploration is debilitating towards the science spectrum and the effect it can have on people's ambitions to become engineers and astronauts and scientists? Do you think it has a debilitating effect that the national perspective towards it has decreased?
Well, I mean, I personally, you know, space is, whether I'm thinking about how we launch and use satellites in space or human beings in space or, you know, going back to the moon, onto Mars, I can't imagine not being excited by that. And I'll tell you, when I end up talking to people, and that's why the art to me is so interesting, is that it allows you to engage with audiences that might not even know there's a space station, or, you know, will think that when we go on the space shuttle, we're going to the moon, you know, or when are we going to send people back to Mars? I mean, there's this lack of understanding of what's really going on. And to be able to talk to people, you know, to make a connection with folks and then really talk about what we are doing in space, people are genuinely excited about that when they're exposed to it. And I've never met anybody who, you know, they might not want to go to space themselves, but when you start talking to them about what's going on in space, you know, just even with the space station, 17 years of having people continuously living off and working off our planet. And as long as my son has been alive, we've been living on Earth and off Earth, you know, continuously. And that is an exciting proposition. And the people that I've encountered that don't know we have a space station and then find out, they are the ones with the app on their phone wanting to know, you know, when it's flying over. So I think it's a matter of exposing people. Of exposing people to it and generating that excitement again. NASA has never been good at promoting NASA. Absolutely not. NASA does a really good job communicating with the people that already love NASA. Which is why I think most astronauts who retire from the astronaut office, most people who've worked in the space industry, they feel a personal obligation to sharing that in some unique way. Because we know, you know, NASA on its own has never been good at really telling the story about all the great stuff going on. I don't know if this answers your question at all, but I think when people find out about space, they are excited about space.
Maybe the lack of exposure is why the national.
Yeah, I think, and that's why I'm thinking, you know, I was telling a few folks about, I'm supporting this show that National Geographic is doing called One Strange Rock. And it's this 10 episode docuseries on Earth. I mean, the One Strange Rock is Earth, is what they're talking about. And And each episode has an astronaut that's kind of sharing a backstory to it, you know, relating the spaceflight experience to this whatever phenomenon about the planet or what we're learning about the planet. And I'm really excited about that getting out there, because Nat Geo has a way of luring people in. And then once I think people are, you know, see the first episode, they're going to want to watch the second episode. And they're going to start thinking about, oh my gosh, I live on a planet. It's a pretty cool place, you know. It's like a spaceship. It's got its own little, you know, system that allows us to stay alive here. Oh, we better take care of it and each other. And then thinking about how we fit in this grander scheme. And that's what the space program is all about to me. And so things like that, if we can get that out there through other outlets besides NASA, I think it'll be good.
Thank you.
Thank you. I really
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
All right.
Hi, I'm Matt. I'm a member of SS. Can you guys hear me? Yeah? Cool.
A little bit. A little closer.
Get a little closer to the microphone. Yeah. Right. Would be good.
I'm Matt.
Go Rockstar. There you go.
All right, there. Yeah. I'm a member of SSV, which is a volunteering group here at Seminole State. And one of your stories that stood out to me was about how you were painting in space and how bizarre of like an activity that was. Instead of having your cup of water, you have a sphere of water just floating, and it goes to your paintbrush, and it's just so willing to latch itself onto anything that you're brushing it on. I was wondering, how has being in space and orbiting Earth and seeing the raw beauty of Earth affected your perspective as an artist?
Well, I think it's it has like total influence over, you know, over the art I want to do. You know, there's plenty of subjects out there to paint, but I just always keep coming back to those views I had out the window, or, you know, some image that somebody took of the rocket ship I launched on, or the spacewalk I was on, because it's one of those experiences that I know I did it. You know, like there's a picture that I show, one of my very favorite pictures, looking out the window of the space shuttle, you know, that my crewmate Steve Bowen took while he was out on a spacewalk of us back in the crew module. And I know I was there, but I am so thankful for that picture, because it, you know, it proves to me in my own mind that I was there. It's such a surreal thing to really, you know, latch on to the fact that that happened. And so to me, those experiences, what I saw through the window, I think forever will be inspiration for me. And hopefully my painting it, my sharing it will help other people maybe understand it a little more. The other thing that I've been painting is some of the scenes from the Nemo mission too, because I think there's such a parallel to, you know, there's an analog not only to what it's like to fly in space, but this opportunity to experience Earth from a totally new vantage point, you know, very special vantage point. And you know, if I can share that inner space versus outer space kind of perspective, I think is really important for ultimately allowing people to, I keep saying this, you know, like look at Earth as a planet, look at it as our home, and do a little bit of Earth and Earthling appreciation as a result of it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Artist, right here, yeah.
Thank you. I am an astrophysics major at UCF, and there's a noticeable disparity of women in the program and in STEM programs in general. But the more I talk with, you know, fellow women on campus, I find them saying, I wish I would have done that, or I really think that's cool, I love science, I want to be a part of that mm-hmm. program. So my question is, how do we start these conversations on our campuses or with our young girls and try to get them motivated to stay in these programs and stay interested?
Well, I think that you know, you've recognized it, you know, you're experiencing it. So, you know, if you or your, you know, your counterparts, I mean, get out to the local elementary schools. I mean, seriously, just go to, you know, find somebody you know that's a teacher, you know, at an elementary school. And you don't have to go there even deliberately, you know, targeting the girls in those classes. But if you go there and make yourself present and visible to, you know, young girls that are, at that point in time, quite honestly, doing a lot better in, you know, math and science than the boys will in those classes. And if you can encourage them just by being there to see some, you know, see something interesting about it, or see something, you know, that they might want to be curious about, you know, that would encourage them to continue in, you know, math or science or, you know, something like that, then I think that's the greatest thing you can do. And if you've got a community of women at the university, you know, go in mass. Because I really do think there is a, you know, there's a see it, be it thing to it. And it's one thing to say, hey, we'll go, you know, we'll talk to our university counterparts, but we gotta hit a, you gotta hit them young. So that they show up at university, you know, with that interest already, and then, you know, grow it from there. It's just like I was on the selection committee for not the last class, but the class before of astronauts. And we were, you know, all these applications are coming through, and we're like, where are all, I mean, there were a lot of women that were applying, but not as many as I would have thought. And I'm like, where is the women applicants in all of this? And, you know, not that you want to go in saying, okay, we're going to pick 8 people, 4 of those will be women. You want to pick the best candidates, but you need the pool available to you to even pick from. And if they're not making it, I mean, if they're not enrolling in programs at university because somewhere along the way in elementary school, someone said to them or they decided for some obscure reason that, you know, science and math isn't cool for girls, which, by the way, it totally is. Oh, where'd you go? You know, we got to get them young.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you. All right, so I'm going to interject with a stage question. This one should be a little simpler for you.
So, as in, Nikki, keep it short?
No. As in, I'm pretty sure I already know the answer to this. So we meet astronauts. We get really, really spaced out, like, pun intended, I guess. Who is that for you? Who have you met that made you just stop in your tracks?
A lot of people, actually. But I would say the number one, Alan Bean. Alan Bean is, you know, he was an Apollo astronaut, Apollo 12, and also he was a Skylab guy. But Alan Bean was the first astronaut to retire from the astronaut office to become an artist. And so, I mean, here's this guy all wrapped up in one, like hero stuff, space hero stuff, and artsy hero stuff. And he has been the most welcoming, humble, gracious person, you know, has invited me to his studio to see his art, to see how he paints. I mean, he is an engineer in the way he does his paintings. But, and he shared with me, he's like, yeah, you know, Nicole, if I'm gonna paint an 11 by 14 of this view of, you know, this image from my, you know, my moon landing, I have an 11 by 14, you know, picture of that, and I've got the grid on it. And, you know, he wants every detail to be perfect from kind of the engineering side of it. But then he's like, yeah, but you know, there's no purple on the moon, there's no pink on the moon or blues on the moon. And he's like, that's where I get all artsy, you know, is because Monet is like his you know, his artistic inspiration. And he wants to talk art. And I've got still saved on my phone, you know, this message from Alan Bean, hey, Nicole, if you're going to do this kind of, you want to get this kind of paintbrush, you know, to do that. I'm like, oh my gosh, Alan Bean called me and left a message on my phone. And, you know, that kind of thing, I think when you can, because, you know, Gene Cernan, one of those guys, John Young, who just passed away, one of the most amazing, you know, people who stayed around, you know, committed, dedicated his entire career to the astronaut office and the space program and how do we fly safely and what he learned from flying on STS-1 and every other vehicle before that, you know, and all these, I mean, I just, the list goes on. And, you know, as an astronaut, we have these astronaut reunions every couple years, and I remember going to the first one of those, and you're just like, oh my gosh, you know, you're like doing that, like, okay, you know, look at the thing. And what's cool about, and you thought you were going to get a simple answer, what's cool about it too is that, you know, and I had this conversation with Alan Bean too, was, I mean, this man walked on the moon, I mean, did work on the moon. He, you know, was a Skylab guy, you know, that first kind of space station experience for U.S. astronauts and stuff. And he tells me that the Skylab mission, he felt like more of an astronaut than he ever did when he was on the moon, you know, because of the work they did up there and the time he was there. But those guys talked to
you know, to me, to my contemporaries, to the, you know, the current astronauts, like, they can't believe that, you know, they're like, we spent this much time on the moon. We were doing, you know, to do a spacewalk was, you know, incredible, but we really had, we only had this much time to do it. Look at how many, you know, the kind of work we're doing every day that's just routine almost on the space station now. They couldn't have imagined doing that kind of work. And so they're, you know, when they say they're in awe of what we do now, I mean, that to me is really reflective of how proud we should be, I think, of, you know, even though we all think we should have flying cars and we should be living on Mars already and all of that, I mean, we should be really proud of the work that we're doing in space every day.
All righty, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So what type of advice would you give a student or anyone who, yeah, really wants to be an astronaut, an artist, but not necessarily lacking the motivation, but strategies to, you know, get through that class, put in those 10 years, not let the haters get to them, like, you're never gonna become an astronaut. Like, what were those strategies that you took in order to stay motivated that to meet that end goal?
Yeah, I think you gotta find your people, really. I mean, that's one thing. I mean, I found, like, when I ended up at Embry-Riddle, I really realized, wow, I am, you know, with my people. And the same thing was with the folks that were out at the airport. You know, they were supportive. They wanted to share what they were excited about. And I think that's a really important thing, because there's always going to be, you know, I may not remember who that person was, but somebody along the way probably told me, you know, what do you think? You could fly airplanes, or, you know, don't waste your time applying to be an astronaut. That's, you know, one in however many people have that happen to them. It's like, you know. And I pinch myself still that ever happened. But I think you have to, it goes back to the other gentleman's question. I mean, if you can encourage somebody to continue to pay attention to what they enjoy, it sounds almost selfish, like, pay attention to what you enjoy. But it's true, it really is. If I got distracted because I was, you know, if I became more motivated by just making more money, I don't think opportunities like astronaut would come along. And I watched some of my colleagues at work, you know, they wanted the next pay scale. You know, it was like, oh, I gotta go get this job because it's gonna pay me more money. I'm gonna get the next grade, you know, pay grade. And they didn't even enjoy what they were doing. And I don't think, I mean, they're probably still doing that job. I think really you have to pay attention to what you're curious about and what excites you. Sounds really, it's not a really great answer, but I think it's at the heart of it.
Yeah, thank you. All right. Yes, sir.
Hear me?
Yep,
what does an astronaut actually study?
What does an astronaut actually study, like, for school before you become an astronaut? You know, it's so great because you can study almost anything. So I studied engineering, the kind of engineering that taught me about how airplanes fly and how rocket ships fly. But some of the people that were in my astronaut class were medical doctors, so they went to medical school. One of my classmates was a geophysicist, so he learned all about how, I mean, his focus was the Earth. How's the Earth made? You know, what are the layers? What's at the center of it? You know. Those kinds of things, an oceanographer who, you know, studying how our ocean is made and works, and, you know, fighter pilots. And so there's all different kinds of things that you can study. But for me, I loved flying, so that's why I chose aeronautical engineering, because it's like it had something to do with what I enjoyed. And so that's the thing I would tell you the most. There's certain kinds of things, if you want to be an astronaut, that you have to do, like science or engineering or flying, those kinds of things. But there's really lots of opportunity in all of that to do many different things. And then learn another language. Just add that on too.
Thank you. All right, so we've got another online question. Just the absurdity of it, I've got to ask you.
Okay.
So this is from Renee.
It's really a sphere, it's not flat. Yeah.
Oh.
What is it like to sneeze in space?
To sneeze in space, and I have done that. It's not pretty if you know it's coming. Yeah, because it just, you know, that whole Newton thing about once in motion kind of thing. That's true with vomiting too. I'll just say that. Yeah, sneezing in space, it's you. If you can know it's coming, you want to contain it. But it's kind of, I mean, it's really kind of like the same as down here. It just, the splatter effect is a little different.
Can it propel you in the opposite direction?
Can it propel you in the opposite direction? Probably. If you really, yeah, probably. Yeah, is sneeze really what you were going for there?
Yeah, that's right. We'll just let the imagination go there. No. All right, over there, sir.
Good evening. My name is Lorenzo. Hi. I had two questions. First, during the time you spent in space, you said you were there for several months. What were some of the experiments or like projects that stood out most to you that you did?
I think, you know, what was really neat about it was when I was there, we had, and it's even more now, with the way they've got the facilities set up and stuff, but there were over 100 active research investigations going on any given day. And it was neat because there were things that the crew members were, you know, actively involved with, you know, really working right in the middle of the experiment. There were things where we just, you know, flicked the switch or checked the specimen or whatever, you know, kind of not actively, but, you know, just reporting to the ground. And then we were the experiment too, which was kind of neat. So any day on station, somebody was wired up with something, you know, the thing, you know, do they still have a brain? How's it working? You know, our hearts still beat, you know, that kind of thing. You could visibly see, you know, the measurement or the investigation into the, like, the human physiology of being in space going on. And that was neat. And that included, like, I mean, I learned how to draw my own blood because we were doing that so much, you know, and videotape that. I should have videotaped painting in space as much as I did drawing blood in space. But so neat things like that. But the human body in space, both from the standpoint of how are we as humans going to live off Earth, you know, in other extreme environments, and how does our body adapt to that? But by looking at how our body works in microgravity in response to it, we learn more about what's going on with our bodies down here. And a really great example of that is, you know, the osteoporosis studies that they have going on up there. Because when you get to space, you almost immediately go into this accelerated osteoporosis. Your body and your brain are really cool because you're in microgravity now. They figure out very quickly how to adapt to that new environment, so you learn how to move gracefully around in, you know, in that 3D space. But they also figure out very quickly how to adapt to that environment, which means, hey, I don't need bones or muscles anymore, you know, to live here. So they don't waste any energy maintaining them anymore. So we have to figure out how do you counteract that. And as we figure out how to counteract that in a microgravity environment where it's accelerated, we can apply those same things to, you know, to our life down here on Earth. So that's one thing. Some of the experiments that were my favorites were, we have this really great combustion chamber on board the station. And to just look at the interior of the space station, you can't really tell what's going on there. You know, there's a bunch of wires and cables and computers. I mean, it's really kind of messy looking throughout the whole, you know, the lab and the modules. But behind all those panels are some really impressive research facilities. And the combustion chamber is one of those. And almost every day there were different fuel mixtures burning inside of this chamber. And if you got a chance to look at the video of it, you'd see these like perfectly shaped spheres of fire, you know, burning inside there. So that was cool just to see that. But then to know that by being in the microgravity environment, taking gravity out of the equation and burning that mixture of fuel, you can learn so much more about the properties of it, the efficiency of it, the pollutive nature of it, than you can by burning them down here on Earth. And so it's kind of a simple thing, you know, it's almost science fair experiment kind of stuff. If you really think about it, it's re-looking at things we already think we really understand and taking gravity out of the equation to learn more about it. And probably the other favorites were plant growth experiments, because it's really neat to have, and plants are easy to grow up there, whether they have the same nutritional value or not, or content is what, you know, they're learning more about that and how to do that. But just to have you know, plants around, and to be able to harvest those and interact with them was really fun.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Just a one more question. I'm studying photonic engineering right now at UCF, and what would you recommend, what activities or skills I should focus on as years before my position, or in terms of they must be working in space?
So what kind of engineering are you doing?
Photonic engineering.
Photonic?
Yes, it deals with optics.
Okay, sounds like you're already super smart anyway, so I don't even tell you. You know what I would say, you know, if you know what you want to do in school, kind of thing, what you're wanting to study. One of the things we looked for in the interview process, you know, for from the astronaut standpoint, and I would say this applies to any other job in the space industry as well, is how are you taking what you're learning in school and looking at it from the reality standpoint? How does this really, what I'm studying in school, how is that going to improve life on Earth? How is it going to make it easier for rockets to launch, or you know, whatever it might be. But what improvement, what goodness is going to come from what you're studying? And hopefully there's some motivation in that. I mean, there's some, you know, you want to add value to, you know, life around you in you know, through what you're studying. And I, you know, the space program to me is a wonderful place to apply that. But I would be thinking more and more about what is it that I'm studying that in the reality of life is going to be, you know, make things better.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
I have two questions. The first one is, during your time, have you ever seen an eclipse, a partial eclipse?
In space, partial. I did see partial, and it's really cool because you kind of see it moving, you know, that shadow, you know, on the Earth. What was neat, you know, if you watched the, did you see the recent eclipse that we had?
Yeah.
Did you see, was it total where you saw it?
Yes.
Oh.
No, not total, like a
yeah, but even if it's not total, you know, when you watched it, wasn't it cool how, I don't know about you, but I don't, when I look at the moon, I'm not always thinking about the moon as this body in space. You almost look at it like it's this flat, you know, image in the sky. But when the eclipse was going on, it looked round. It looked spherical to me. So hopefully you saw that too.
My second question is about other corporations working with NASA, such as SpaceX and Blue Orion, of those companies. Do they interact with your work at ISS?
Yeah, they do. You know, right now, you know, SpaceX has a cargo vehicle called the Dragon.
Yes.
And so it's one of the ways that we get all of the cargo and experiments and stuff up to the space station. But it's also the only way right now that we get things back, you know, back to Earth. All of the other cargo vehicles can only take things to space. You know, the shuttle was this really beautiful way to get stuff to and from the station. So Dragon's nice that way. And then the orbital vehicle Cygnus allows us to get stuff to space, and also the Russians' Progress vehicle. But the commercial companies, the private companies, more and more there's going to be interaction between NASA and those companies. And if you think about it already, when we built the space shuttle, you know, NASA didn't build the space shuttle. Rockwell built the space mm-hmm. shuttle. And then you had Boeing that, you know, and other contractors, other companies that built the space station. But it just, the way they did it, it became NASA's space station or space shuttle. Now, you know, SpaceX is still getting money from NASA to do the work that they're doing and build the rockets and the spacecraft, but they'll get to own it instead of NASA owning it.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. All right, over here.
Hi, Nicole.
Hi.
I had a question about how is life coming back to Earth? Like, you leave a pencil and expect it to stay in midair? Like, how is it adjusting?
A little bit.
Yeah?
So, you know, I had heard from my friends that flew before me, you know, some of them had that experience where, you know, this one guy, his wife wouldn't let him use real dishes for, you know, a few days after getting back because he would just, you know, drop them and break them. But, so I had that in my head. I'm like, yeah, I don't really want to drop and break my own dishes. So, you know, that, I don't ever remember that happening, but vivid experience from the 133 mission, getting back. We're on the runway. I flew as MS-2 on landing, so sitting right between the pilot and the commander. And we're on the runway, and Eric Bowe, my pilot, says, hey, Nicole, could you pass me my helmet bag? And those were all shoved behind me, my seat. And so I went to get it for him, and I go to hand it to him, and it's just this flimsy, lightweight mesh bag, you know? And I go to hand it to him, and he's like, oh, stand by, just stick it there on the console. So we're both still looking at it, and I let go of it. And we both, it was kind of that like dog head tilt, you know, thing, because I let go of it, and both of us at that point in time expected that what we would see was this floating bag in front of us. Instead, I let go of it, and it collapsed onto the console, you know, onto the center console, like, and we both did. We're like, is that weird? Yeah, that was weird. And then just went on, but it looked like it must have weighed 100 pounds, I mean, the way it hit that console. And then you're like, eh, okay, and then you just go on. But it really is kind of your brain again, having to get those signals to know, you know, hey, this is what gravity's doing to me. And then of course you get up and you feel like you weigh 500 pounds. But yeah,
thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, sir.
I have two questions.
Yes, sir.
When you launched, like, when you felt the G's, how did it feel like?
It felt like all I needed to do was, you know, woohoo loudly and high five and smile. But, you know, what was really great about the space shuttle is that the G's, it was like 3 G's is what you felt the most during launch, and which is really not that bad when it comes to G's, and it's through your chest. So unlike in an airplane where it comes through, you know, if you're doing loops and flying around doing aerobatics in an airplane, it's like through your head, and you really feel like you're getting squished down like that, and you gotta breathe right and all of that. On the launch, that didn't feel like that so much, but it did feel like 3 of you were sitting on top of you, and then you felt like you weighed 3 times as much, and you were shaking like you never imagined, like jello inside. Pretty cool.
It was like jello.
Like jello. And I'll tell you what, I have watched that, you know how they had we had cameras set up inside of the cockpit, and I've watched those videos. And yeah, you see some shaking, but I'm like, that is not what I felt. I felt like my internals were, when those solid rocket boosters were lit, it felt like you were just jiggling big time inside.
I'm talking about both launches.
Both of them, absolutely. And I thought when I went and launched on the second time that I knew, you know, I'm like, ah, I've been here, done this, I know what it feels like. It still feels just as awesome.
I mean like all your launches.
Hmm? 2.
Just on the space shuttle?
Yeah, just on the space shuttle.
Hmm. My second question is, like, how was it underwater?
Underwater was really cool, too. And I highly recommend that as well. If you can... You know,
did you see any blue whales?
I didn't see any blue whales, but I did. You know what I did this summer? It wasn't while I lived underwater for that mission, but a friend of mine told me about this, and I never even knew that this would be on my bucket list, but it immediately went on there when I found out about it. I went with my family and some friends, and we went to the other side of the planet, over to Tonga, which is kind of near Fiji and that whole area. And we snorkeled with humpback whales.
Did you see any catfish?
Catfish, I see in my lake and at home, yeah. Yeah, humpback whales are more awesome than catfish.
Thank you.
I like strawberries, yeah, okay.
I like strawberries,
I
too.
I do, too, yeah. Thank you for your questions.
All right, so since we've got a repeat question over here, we're actually gonna stay over here for one more. Then we'll probably have time for one or two more questions, and then Nicole's got a little something.
Yeah, we need to see a little video.
Yeah.
Okay, hopefully really quick. As one of the 18,000 applicants that were not selected from their last class, in your opinion, is there a particular personality trait or key experience that I think sets certain applicants apart from others?
You know, I don't know. I really don't know. What I would say to you is, and I tell this to students that are asking me about how to fill out the application for, is really look at that application. I mean, because it's just the standard NASA job application. It's like for any job at NASA. I think what you have to do in that application is look at the questions a little bit differently. Like, figure out how to answer those questions in a way that answers the immediate question, but also allows you to share a little bit more about yourself, you know, outside of what the typical resume would be. You know, so, and I can't even think of an example of the question, but figure out how to incorporate into those answers the things you like doing outside of work, you know, the hands-on, you know, experiential kinds of things that you enjoy, and a way to share that that's not really easy to do. I mean, it's difficult because it's just this standard off-the-web application. But I think that's what ends up standing out, is that, you know, the character of the person comes out and the answer is a little bit differently. The things you enjoy doing that kind of take you outside of the classroom, outside of your, you know, of your work environment, that really tells about who you are. Because when you do get there to interview, you know, they see your resume, you know, and everybody can read the resume, but what they want to do is talk to you as a human being. Would I want to be on the space station for 6 months with you? And a lot of those things about who you are as a person and what you enjoy doing outside of the classroom and the workplace is what will make that answer yes. So.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're
next
welcome.
Time.
Good luck. Yeah, next time.
All right.
Do it.
Hey.
Hi.
I mentioned this the first time, but I was listening to the girl that was a UCF student, astrophysicist, artist. And if anyone here is a UCF student and is interested in astronomy by chance, there is the Astronomy Society at UCF. And anyone listening online, it would be Astronomy Society at UCF on the Facebook.
Very good.
My question is, how did being in space affect your sleep, and does it still affect you now?
Sleep in space was the best sleep I've ever had in my entire life. Aside from like the first 2 days of the first mission where, you know, your spine is kind of stretching out and so you get this lower back pain that is kind of nagging, but then it just goes away. Like after 2 days, it's gone, you know. And on the second flight, I knew my spine elongated, but I didn't notice that pain again. But sleeping in space was absolutely, for me, the most comfortable. I mean, I got in my sleeping bag, floated in that bag, and woke up in the same position in the morning. And I woke up to the alarm. I mean, I wasn't rolling over and waking up in the middle of the night. When the light went off, within 5 minutes, I was asleep, and it was the alarm that got me up, either the one I'd set or the emergency one going off in the middle of the night. Some people don't say that. I mean, some people don't really need that feeling like their head is against a pillow or, you know, that their body is, you know, against something. I didn't need that. And I don't sleep anything like that down here on Earth. I don't. The other thing I will say about sleep is people a lot of times ask about dreams. And, you know, what did I dream about in space? Did my dreams change in space? I think in space what happened is I started incorporating the experience of being space. That started, you know, showing up in my dreams too, and it does still now. But the one thing I know that overall changed about my dreams was before I flew in space, I used to have those dreams about running and jumping and fly, you know, trying to fly. And sometimes that would happen, sometimes it wouldn't. It would be kind of frustrating in the dream, you know, if it didn't happen. And ever since flying in space, I have never had that dream ever again. And I don't know if it's because your body gets it, you know, knows what it's like to move that way or what, but I've never had that dream again since flying in space.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
And then our final question this evening, Miss, go ahead.
Okay, so I have two questions.
make it work.
The first is from me personally, and then the second is from my sister.
Okay.
So, first, you were talking to me earlier, me, Billy behind us, my sister. Women should get more like into science and math.
think there's, you know, there's a tendency to believe what people are saying, you know, are telling you. I'm really thankful that I didn't have that happen, because I don't know what I would have done. I feel really, really bad when I hear that happening to, you know, happening to other kids, when I see it happening. I mean, I've seen it in schools, you know, before, with, you know, with teachers saying things to kids, and I'm like, that is completely unacceptable. No teacher should ever say to any student, you can't do something, unless it's, you know, you're sticking your finger in the electrical socket or something, you know, no, don't do that. But it should be total encouragement, you know, for students, for kids in school. What I would say is you kind of go with your gut, you know, you really do. You know you love science. You know that you're excited about what you're learning when you do science experiments at your birthday party. I mean, if you're doing science experiments at your birthday party, you know you love science. And the fact that you share it with your friends, they're going to get excited about it too. So that's kind of the thing you got to keep doing.
And then my second question that comes from Lizzie right over here. She says, what does ice cream taste like in space?
Ice cream tastes like ice cream in space because unlike that, you know, they have the astronaut ice cream, the foamy kind of stuff that you melt in your mouth. Well, we didn't have that there. What we had was little things of Bluebell ice cream. That because they would send up freezers for the science stuff to come back, for the samples, and they'd go up, most of the time they'd go up empty. And so if they could power them going up, they would bring up little treats for us, which usually were the little cups of regular ice cream. And then if you knew Marsha Ivins, one of the other astronauts, she made these really excellent baked goods, and I had my birthday in space, and she sent up this chocolate cake that was, it's like having brownie a la mode in space. It's awesome.
That's about as good as the final questions we can ask for.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, and so we have a short video that Nicole has wanted to play for us. So something nice and inspiring to send us off this evening. So guys, whenever you're ready, we'll play that.
And I love this video. To me, this video kind of speaks to why we do space stuff anyway. You know, it's really all about what kind of world we want. Can we turn the lights off?
Got a package full of wishes, a time machine, a magic wand, a globe made out of gold. No instructions or commandments, laws of gravity or indecisions to uphold. Printed on the box I see, chance, grab a piece, help me to believe it. What kind of world do you want? Think anything. Let's start at the start, build a masterpiece. Be careful what you wish for. History starts now.
Oh,
All right, so Nicole, before we say goodnight tonight, we do have something special for you. Mm-hmm. And so if you guys want to take care of this. So we had an art piece commissioned specifically for you tonight from one of Orlando's most notable artists. His name is Brian Demeter. And in a lot of ways, we knew that when we brought you out tonight, being an astronaut is amazing. Being an artist, it's a way that connects you to so many more people that maybe
got a package full of wishes.
Art is what brings them in. And we thought that there was no better way for us to commemorate our evening with you and you coming out and speaking all this time than something that we think reflects precisely the kind of person you are. So, Brian, if you want to come on over and we'll present this to you now.
Are
Nicole,
you the artist?
For you.
Oh my gosh, that is awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Where can I see some of your other work, too?
Oh, my info is on the back.
Is it on
and
the
I'm
back?
And I'm Derek's brother.
Oh, okay.
That was the other little thing.
Did you guys see? Isn't that beautiful? Oh my gosh, thank you so much.
So if you inspire us, we hope that this does something to be able to inspire you.
That's awesome.
As well. And so, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to wish you all a great rest of the evening. Ladies and gentlemen, Nicole Stott.
Thanks, you guys.
Have a great night, everybody.
Hope you like the video, too. That's